everybody, and I'd like to welcome you to episode 12 of The Established Facts. The end is near as we are plowing through all the alignments. Today we're going to talk about chaotic evil. Quickly though, I'm going to let all the guys and lady go around the table and introduce, and so you can all know who's here.
Anton.
Big Don.
Deb.
Josh.
Wild Bill.
And live via satellite.
Hey, it's Derek.
I think that's the first time Deb didn't say doctor.
Sorry. Do you want me to do it again?
No, we're good.
Okay.
And as always, I am your host. I'm Mike. Tony.
Bum, bum, bum.
Absolutely. This is when all the evil music hits and all the lights go out and the scary stuff happens.
And the reason why chaotic good people want to torture someone.
That's
true.
Oh,
that's true.
Found it. Oh.
So, Tony.
Cue the explosions.
You get the luxury, or in luxury, I guess, to talk about chaotic evil.
Indeed.
So, here's your spotlight, sir.
Well, chaotic evil is not alignment style that I generally play, but for me, it really comes down to evil. I mean, really, it is the root of evil styles. Some examples that I've got of evil characters: Gollum from Lord of the Rings, the Joker, Lord Voldemort, and Lore from Star Trek.
Hey, I like it.
I found some articles online going back to chaotic evil, and this one probably has one of the best things I found. It's called the Chaotic Evil Code. It's 10 items for a chaotic evil character. It's you shall lie whenever convenient. You shall harm the innocent whenever convenient. You shall kill for pleasure. You shall not aid the weak. You shall not honor any other before yourself. You shall break the law whenever convenient. You shall betray friends, family, community, nation whenever convenient. You shall harm those who protect the weak or honor laws. You shall pursue all forms of pleasure. You shall seek unlimited power over others and unlimited freedom for yourself. The Chaotic Evil Code. And I honestly, you can't really top that.
Wow.
Derek, I know you're all the way in Vermont, but I can just see you jumping in your chair with your hand up, ready to talk about this.
I have been waiting for this alignment so long.
I'm trying to figure out why they gave it to me.
Why do you
not
think
you?
Why do you think we put it towards the end? Your suffering brings me great pleasure.
Oh,
I'm still trying to figure
sure
out why
it
they
does.
Gave it. Why did they give it to me and not you? You could pull off chaotic evil so much better.
Yeah.
It's the torture.
GM.
Okay, we have been talking about this character for quite some weeks now.
Mm-hmm.
This is
walk.
The character for this alignment, and that's Chupa.
Still should have let you die in the cavern.
Right.
Yeah, you should have.
Stupid Ewok.
Chupa, for everybody that's not initiated, is an Ewok in the Knights of the Old Republic. Please ignore the time frame problem of having Ewoks around.
Uh-huh.
But Chupa is definitely chaotic evil. As a distraction, he set off a thermo detonator and killed a city block worth of people. Just as a distraction.
Yes.
He started throwing Molotov cocktails at workers in an office building. Started fires. He likes to carry around hallucinogenic and uppers and downers of drugs and so forth. He likes to just randomly see what happens when he sticks people with them, as well as set them airborne. So as far as a chaotic evil character, this is probably one of the epitomes of this alignment. He likes to see things blow up. He likes to see what happens when he does something, and if there's an obstacle, there is a very large explosion that will take care of that obstacle. So that is what I believe chaotic evil is that there is always a solution, and it normally involves death.
I have a comment to go with, obviously nowhere connected to Chupa, because there's no such thing as being connected to Chupa.
Amen.
And his party will tell you so. But we have played in a D&D campaign in the system of 3.5. And I played a character, and when the campaign started, I was very much a chaotic evil character. Donald played my big brother. I was a drow. He was my big brother. He, I believe, was neutral when the game started. I very much, not unlike Chupa, I very much had the mindset that if you didn't agree with me outright, then I had a bunch of spells that would make you, or at the very least, get you out of my way. Again, not unlike Chupa, that he just likes to do things to watch and see what happens. In this time frame when I was in Chaotic Evil, I allegedly, and I say allegedly, melted a city and killed everyone in it.
There's no allegedly about it. I watched you do it.
It wasn't a whole city. It was like 5 or 6 blocks.
But it got
there.
It got blown up to allegedly melting a city.
Yeah.
Oh, that's awesome.
I'll come to your defense, brother.
Right. I held a mayor in this allegedly melted city, held him hostage and tortured him while letting him watch his entire family burn in the city.
Levitating above it.
Right, levitating him above it.
Yeah.
Oh, I love the commentary, just play by play. Please, let's prove how much of an evil butt
he was.
Yes.
and as, I guess, my expression and my involvement with Chaotic Evil is it lets you really just... You really just sit and think. You sit back and you watch what's going on, and you literally, this is exactly what happened. I go, what is the absolute fastest way I can get my answer? And I go, awesome, I'm going to take that mayor, I'm going to hold him in the air, and I'm going to destroy his city right in front of him. That's exactly what I'm going to do. And that's exactly his thought process he went through. What is, you know, if A is my goal, what is the absolute fastest way to get from point B to point A, barring no rules? Donald?
Totally agree.
A couple examples that I can think of for Chaotic Evil. One, Jafar from Aladdin, which is one of my favorite Disney movies, totally has no regard for anyone else's life besides his own. Is willing, as many people who have seen the Disney movie Aladdin, at the end, he's even willing to go as far as to making himself a genie because the genie is more powerful than he is, even though he is the most powerful sorcerer in the world. And so, really, he has zero regard for anyone else's life that might get in the way of his ultimate goal of being the most powerful being in the world. The other example that I have, there was an evil campaign or an evil game that many of us played in, and I had a lot of fun with it because playing a chaotic evil character, it eliminates any limitations that you might have had as a good character. So you can be selective in the things that you like to do to people that are not nice. But I played a shape changer, and there was a point.
Weren't you a doppelganger?
Yes, thank you. I was a doppelganger, and there was a point in which I had to get information, very similar to Mike's character. I had to get information from a woman who was a nun in an orphanage. And because she would not give me the information, now, I'm going to try and keep this as PG as I can, but basically, I had my way with her, and then I burnt the orphanage down to the ground. I mean, that's the most extreme, but it was the same mentality. What can I do to this person that is so extreme that they can do nothing but give me the answers that I want?
Interesting. Bill?
Yeah.
Okay, well, you guys have some interesting thoughts on what chaotic evil is, and I want to disagree with Don, but I'm not going to. I think so far the examples that I've heard, I think Derek's was close, and Jafar was a good example. But the characters that Mikey played and Don played, this is where I'm going to disagree with you, Don, is that I think a chaotic evil character doesn't have a goal. I don't know if we all agree on this, but we think that the Joker is the epitome of what chaotic evil is. And although we think he has a goal, it exactly goes back to what Tony said, was they do everything they can for themselves, pleasure, and whatever strikes them at that moment. So they're, if they have any thoughts or goals, it changes every second for whatever best suits that situation at that point. So here's my best way to describe the perfect chaotic evil character. I believe in some past episodes, someone here likes Kinder.
I said Kinder.
We all
kind
of do. Not we all. Now, don't even say we all.
Kinder are not
sorry.
Are not chaotic evil. But if you take what a Kinder is and you do a 180 with it, and you have someone who's doing things without a goal in mind, they're doing things all for themselves, for their own pleasure, for whatever, without thinking about it, it just happens. And add evil to it, it's the evil Kinder. They slay and kill, and they're not even thinking about it. There is nothing in their mind that they're doing is wrong, or they don't even think about it. And to me, that's what the Joker is.
Yeah.
The Joker, 1 second, will have you think he likes you, then stab you for no reason. And a Kinder, we all know, steals and moves and has wanderlust and travels and like, well, how'd I even get here? Because they kind of lose momentarily reality with what they're doing. And so I think a good example of a chaotic evil is the polar opposite of a Kinder. It's that ability to run around and not almost, you have to be insane to be that way, which is what why the Joker is so good.
Tony, what you got?
I got another list for you guys. Things, actions that are honorable to a chaotic evil character. Accused of a crime, innocent or not. Attacking an unarmed or obviously inferior opponent. Convicted of a crime. Delivering death blow to a helpless opponent. Desecrating an enemy's corpse. Dirty fighting. Falsely claiming the bragging rights that belong to another or outright lying. Fleeing a fight. Gloating over a victory. Killing a host who has provided food, or provided you food or shelter. Neglecting to properly bury a member of your own race. Paying off an extortionist or shakedown. Perpetuate a humiliating prank on an enemy. Refusing a fair contest or challenge. Reporting the illegal actions of an enemy to authorities when profitable. Taking a bribe. Taunting an enemy into fighting. Treason, unjustly slaying a prisoner or an unarmed opponent who has yielded and walking away from a challenge.
What you got over there, Derek?
One of the things that I was thinking about as far as chaotic evil is concerned, for some reason, Mythbusters came up to mind, and with all the explosions that they do on there, and from my perspective, it's like I can play a character that can just do what I want to do, make the biggest explosion without regard to the law, without regard to the without regard to hurting other people. It's like I can just see things blow up, and you know, and on some visceral level, that is fun. I mean, it's always a little bit weird to play evil characters sometimes, because it's like, well, geez, well, you wouldn't do that in real life, would you? Or stuff like that. It's just, I don't know. It can be a little bit strange, but I mean, I just went back to the, you know what, sometimes people just like to see things blow up. Which brought me to Mythbusters and that sort of thing. So
weird segue.
Wild Bill,
Derek, I agree with you. I think in real life, kind of a chaotic evil character that we can see in the news and that we can relate to is an arsonist, someone who lights something on fire and then sits back and enjoys that moment. No, regardless of who suffers, what happens, what destruction, it's relishing in what they have done, and And that, I think that's what we can look at as a chaotic evil person and what who we can relate to in our daily lives. And I've tried to think of someone like the Joker in our life to compare this to, but it's not coming to my mind. And if someone thinks of that, please speak up at some point, because I'm trying to come up with someone else to get that feeling.
Well, Josh, almost any serial killer.
That was actually exactly what I was going to say, Derek.
The issue I have with the serial killers is a lot of them do it. Now, again, I'm not an expert by any stretch of the imagination, but a lot of them have something that has set off a mental affliction in their mind. Now, they're not all mentally ill, but a lot of people like to brandish them all as mentally ill. But they go after a profile. They have a goal, usually. It's obviously, if you're a serial killer, you're not just, I don't know of very many that just walk down the street and go, you and you and you and you and you, and just haphazardly just take people out. Most of them have like a set goal. Like, I'm going to get the pretty blonde-haired chick between the ages of 20 and 23, and I'm going to choke her to death with my shoelaces. And so, yeah, I think they're evil, absolutely. I don't think it's so much on the verge of chaotic, because I think they're very methodical with what they're picking. They're very, I don't want to say they're organized, but they know what they're doing. They know what they're after.
Do you think lawful, maybe?
I don't know. I don't think they're lawful either. I think they're probably more neutral, because they, in some aspect, they do reap some type of enjoyment, or whatever the goal is they're after when they're killing these poor innocent people. But again, I don't think they're not lawful, because they don't have a set of laws that are, you know, they're not following anything other than the profile of the people they're looking for. And I like, everyone and their brother has their hand up, so I really have no idea who's next. So I'm gonna go to Josh.
Okay, this one may be a small crowd of people. Others may want to look this up, but a few of the people in the room will definitely understand this. You were looking for another character that kind of had that chaotic evil aspect to it. The WWE has had a character over the past few, like a decade or a little bit longer than that. I'm not sure exactly when he debuted, but played by a guy by the name Glenn Jacobs. The character's name is Kane. And initially, when he was introduced as the Undertaker's, you know, younger brother who was scarred for life or whatever, blah blah blah, who would eventually want to get his revenge on the Undertaker. So he kind of had a small base plot, but no one exactly knew who he was in the first couple of months that he just started showing up and decimating people and then leaving. So the first couple of months or whatever of his existence, and even some other characters, he literally would just walk out in the middle of the match, destroy everything in sight, every person, wrestler in sight, and then leave. No particular reason behind it. So, though it may hit a small crowd, that's another example of setting up someone as a chaotic evil character.
Tony, we're kind of expounding on your chaotic evil. Why don't you kind of pull us back in here?
For me, it boils down to, we were talking in a break here a minute ago about it boils down to, if there's one item that is truly chaotic evil, it is the One Ring from Lord of the Rings. And really, it is only about itself and nothing else. It has a will, and it's just about itself. And that is truly the epitome of what chaotic evil is they are only about themselves.
Deb, I saw your hand up. Is it still valid?
It is. I was thinking on it, and I can't decide, so I'm actually going to throw this one out at you. I don't know how many of you have seen this movie. The movie is called Schindler's List, and the character in there of the German, Amon Goeth, is, and I'm debating, trying to decide if he's neutral or if he's chaotic evil, because there's a certain scene where he picks up a long-range rifle, and he just starts randomly shooting Jews for no particular reason. Doesn't really, you know, doesn't even know the names of these people. Just picks up a gun, kind of looks around, looks at one, and then he just randomly shoots one, puts it down, goes back to what he was doing. So I'm debating that, because in a Nazi regime, their purpose, they, you know, that time, the concentration camps that were destroying Jews, but his choice was not methodical. There was really no reason behind it. It was, I feel like shooting someone, I'm going to shoot you, and I'm done. So I'm waffling as to whether that's a neutral or whether that's a chaotic evil kind of character. But when Bill was talking a minute ago, I thought of him with that. I just feel like killing you, and you got the short end of the stick. You're dying today.
I think that you're right, Deb. I think he is chaotic evil.
Mm. Yeah.
Donald?
Yeah. Quickly referring to the short discussion we had about serial killers and people along those lines, typically the biggest thing when it comes to serial killers, a lot of times the reason that they get started in doing what they're doing is because of some sort of feeling of inadequacy. And so they need to find some sort of balance in their life. You know, sometimes it could be impotence, or sometimes it could just be a bad relationship with their family, or for whatever reason. I think a lot of times serial killers are typically, and the only reason I know this is because I have taken a criminal procedures class recently on that kind of a thing, and so it's just kind of fresh in my mind. But I would have to say that if we were going to classify serial killers, it would have to be probably neutral evil, because they are very methodical. They usually have a demographic that they follow. They don't tend to waver a lot of times outside of what their normal targets are going to be, what their normal methods are going to be. That's the reason why they are called serial killers, is because they are serial. They have a series of events that they do every time they go after a target.
Bill?
Back to this serial killer, what Don is going on, that's why I wanted to hop on here, was that I was leaning towards a serial killer being neutral evil or lawful evil. Depending on how you feel about lawful evil. And a prime example of a lawful evil serial killer would be the movie or the show Dexter. He has a code, he follows it, and what he's doing is evil.
Absolutely.
But he follows his code to the T. And you can even think of maybe some dictatorships kind of being lawful evil. Mm-hmm. But then leaning towards neutral evil, the guy, because a serial killer is someone you never expect. And I think if someone's chaotic evil, you pretty much know they're crazy. And they're not hiding out. When they're out in public, you're like, that guy is off.
He's off his rocker.
He's going to walk out someplace and something bad is going to happen. And I am going to move from point A now to point Z because I'm not going to be a part of it. Which I think relates to, is it Derek, your character's name?
Chupa.
Chupa. Mm-hmm. If I see Chupa, I know I should leave the area.
Yes.
Right? Chupa.
Run.
See, if
away.
I heard that, does he say that?
Yes.
He actually does say that. Yeah. It's like an evil Pokemon.
See, I know I need to leave.
Chupa, yeah.
Something, that's my conscience saying,
Go far.
Yeah, go far away, turn around out of this dark alley, because I just heard Chupa, Chupa, Chupa.
Chupa, Chupa, Chupa.
Josh?
Totally just made me think of another possible chaotic evil character. Actually kind of relates to the last episode a little bit. Jaws from the James Bond series. Same type of guy. Every time he shows up, he knows he's either going after somebody or he's just going to kill somebody. He's just there to kill somebody. Bond is always, this guy's always showing up at the worst possible time, and he's either going to kill Bond or kill somebody else. So, now granted, it may be a little more neutral because he's often hired by somebody, whereas chaotic people aren't per se hired, but he's very erratic in just when he shows up, you know. So, that's kind of, I could be completely off my rocker there, but.
Tony, do you have anything you want to wrap us up with, or we pretty much nailed it down?
I think we've pretty much nailed it down.
Well, all right then. Well, it looks like we have one alignment left. In our epic 9 series of alignments. So that's this is where we have a dramatic pause for suspense. Right. So we are moving into our versus topic, and with it being the new year, we thought nothing better than to have our versus topic this this episode to be 2011 versus 2012. Now, unlike most of our versus topics where we go around the table, we each give our opinion about the versus topic, and then we kind of openly debate as a group kind of our opinion of the two topics. This is going to be a little different. It's going to be kind of like Don talking to himself or debating with himself about whether he what the things in 2011 he liked and what he's really looking forward to in 2012. So just bear with us as we get through this. It'll be a little different, but hopefully we should get some good stuff out of it. So I'm going to go ahead and let Deb start. That was my chaotic moment for the evening.
Apparently.
That's, you know, look right, swerve left.
Exactly.
Quick thing. Again, for those of you taking and listening to the podcast, please give us your opinions on Facebook.com, looking for the established facts. We'd like to know what you think on your 2011 versus your upcoming 2012.
That almost sounded canned and professional.
Yeah, I was going to say, you have another career in sales. Right? If this whole engineer thing doesn't work.
All right, Deb.
$5 just fell out of my pocket into his.
Uh-huh.
Just gone. Just gone.
Deb.
You a kinder.
Let's,
what happened?
What happened? That's right. Deb, 2011 versus 2012.
Okay, 2011. Had some really awesome things. I actually got my biggest one as a gamer. I finally got to go to more than one day of Gen Con. I got to go to about 3 days / 3.5 days of Gen Con. That was awesome. I got to move back to Indianapolis from where I was living in Ohio, and I actually was able to get back with my gaming group again. That was another huge plus. Yeah, gaming wise is probably my two biggest things. And then actually living in the same building with my husband, which is really remarkable, by the way. Those of you who are married, make sure you do that. And he has all of these gaming consoles. Like, they're PS3s, there's Wii, there's computer with fast internet. I mean, I'm like in this heaven of console gaming stuff. So that was very cool too. Now, 2012, my goal is to actually go to all 4 days of Gen Con, not 3.5. Not 3.75, 4.
Oh, so you don't want to go to the Pathfinder version of Gen Con?
Oh, that's hard. But no, no. I want to go to Gen Con 4.0.
So you need to tell your friends not to get married during Gen Con.
Yes, I will try to make sure they know that. Anyway, yeah, crazy people. So that's step one. Step two is I actually want to go to Fear the Con. So I want to go to two cons this year. So we're going to step it up from one. And number three, I'm actually going to move up in my job from a year one to a year two, which means I won't have as crazy a schedule. So hopefully I can actually be around for more games.
I have a question for you, Deb.
Yes.
Are you planning on attending MarriageCon with your husband?
If you could only see the looks.
Looks could kill.
Considering that I still haven't been to 4 days of Gen Con, I need to experience that first, so I have 4 days of Gen Con to compare with 4 days of Marriage Con.
So, Anton, you're going to need a funeral con here in a minute.
I can
run that.
Of course you can.
So Marriage Con will be at the earliest 2013 at this time on the schedule.
Wow.
So
Josh had a chaotic evil look in his eyes.
Yes, he did. He had a little bit of the Joker look for just a second.
Towards like, Anton. Yep.
I know. Yep. Anton, awesome. Run away. So yeah, that's my 11 versus 12.
The master of the Marriage Con.
Oh, is that what this is now? Well,
he opened the door. I'm just going to kick it in.
It's kind of a difficult thing, but you know, I get to say that I got my first entire year being married, which, you know, you can't really complain too much about that. I'm very happy and very glad to have a doctor under my roof and in my pocket. But she almost like got sick on her drink. It was kind of funny. But from a gaming perspective, I think 2012 is going to be a very exciting year. You know, we're going to be talking about a little bit more on this later, but you know, we've got a few games that are probably going to be wrapping up in 2012 that put a lot of work into. Of course, as Deb mentioned, the Fear the Con coming up in May, which we're going to give a shout out to the Fear the Boot podcast. If you're curious, just Google Fear the Boot and
they're on there.
Yeah, they are.
They are.
I think it's feartheboot.com, actually.
Yeah.
Am I correct, Eric? All right.
Yes, you are correct.
Okay. So with that being said, that's coming up in May. I'm looking forward to that. And, of course, Gen Con in August. But I think the biggest thing next year, I'm going to get a little more open out there, is where there's a rumor mill out about new gaming consoles being announced next year for all three major folks. I already know Nintendo's talked about their Wii U, as we talked in an earlier episode. So we'll see what Microsoft and Sony has up their sleeve. So from a gaming world, 2012 will be awesome. But, you know, if I have to attend a marriage con in the next year, then I guess we'll have to look into that.
Derek, why don't you tell us about your 2011 versus 2012.
Well, this was a very big year for me. I started a business, a publishing business. Started writing Palgame. It's been a very rocky time for that. Finding reliable artists and finding reliable cohorts to work on this. And as of right now, it just seems like we're not going to make the December release date for the first campaign source book, which is disappointing as well as sneeze inducing.
sorry about that.
I would say that one of my highlights of this year was actually Dragon Con, which is surprising because it's typically not a con that I'm particularly fond of because there's so many people crammed in a very tiny space. But I made a lot of really good contacts there and in the industry, and people really helped me out there. The other thing is that obviously I moved out to Vermont so I can get away from certain people. And
your story is very interesting, Derek. We're going to go ahead and move on to the next person.
Yeah,
but it wasn't you, Mike.
Oh, well then, by all means, keep talking.
Yeah, thank you.
Fine.
Yeah, suck up to the host now.
Yeah.
I just want to make a quick side note. I hate I-90.
Uh-huh.
Yes.
Yeah, whenever you moved here for the same reason you left.
14 hours.
Yeah. D20 Pro has been, so far, crossing fingers, has been working for us as far as continuing on with gaming. Because it is dry up here. I mean, as much fun as people like to poke fun at Vermont, there really isn't a whole lot of people around. It's not a very dense state. And if I really needed gamers, I'd have to like find moose out here to play with.
it's a little tough getting him to roll the dice.
Yeah,
seriously. 2012, I'm hoping to finish, get into a really good publishing groove, getting things out there. I'm looking forward to Fear the Con a lot. I have a scheme up my sleeve for that con. I've been to it all but one time, and I've done different things like donated dice and did some charity work and that sort of thing. This year I'm thinking about if everything gets approved, but holding a raffle for maybe a tablet or two during that con for a charity. I think that'd be sort of kind of interesting. And then hopefully towards the end of the year, going on a cruise with everybody out there. My friends in Indiana, you know, actually physically being in the same room with them would be excellent.
Yikes.
Being on a ship where they're now my captive audience, where I can torture them as much as possible, that would be excellent.
Is he going to be our GM on this
Derek?
Thing?
Derek, it almost, and I stress almost, it almost sounds like you miss us.
Yes, I actually do.
Hey, Derek.
If you torture us too much on the ship, it's probably, I don't know, what, 12 stories to the water?
Yes, Bill, that's exactly where you store the bodies.
Bill, as to not confuse you too much, we are looking at possibly taking a Disney cruise in September, which I'm sure will end up with both drinking and gaming and other merriment that'll happen when we're not on land somewhere, you know. So that way you know what the world we're talking about.
Derek painted a pretty good picture when he said cruise.
Not everyone is as dense as that Vermont state.
Boy. Hey, as the person who helped him move out there, it is as bad as he describes, if not worse.
I
saw snowmobile paths.
I wrapped it all up when he told us he didn't have heat. That's all I needed to know.
Yes.
Derek, are you finished or you still got more?
I'm finished.
Okay. All right. I didn't want to cut you off.
No, it's fine.
Tony, what about your 2011 and 2012?
Well, 2011, it was an interesting year for me because I got back into gaming. I kind of was on a hiatus for a number of years. I went to Gen Con. I'm still planning on going into Gen Con next year. Of course, the gaming cruise. I'm basically calling it that at this point because it's a group of gamers going on a cruise.
Sponsored by Disney.
Yeah. The other part is, for me, for next year, it's really getting into playing more games. Looking forward to the game you're going to be running with 7C. I'd like to get into some more games. I'd like to get into more Pathfinder, but I also like to get into being able to build my own characters a lot faster because I currently am very, very slow at that.
Wild Bill, why don't you elaborate on your 2011 and 2012 for us?
All right, 2011 versus 2012. 2011 gaming was amazing year for me. I got to experience Gen Con for 4 days, which I typically always do. I always take my vacation around it. But also, this is the first year that I stayed and got a hotel room at Gen Con for every night. I was in bed asleep between midnight and 1 every night, and I purposely had an event that started at 9 a.m. every day.
Only an hour of sleep?
No.
You're sleeping too much at Gen Con.
It was, that way I got up and I started my day, and it made it fantastic. And I recommend that to anybody. Also, I've got two gaming groups going now in 2011. I have a Tuesday night group and a Thursday night group that I rotate between, and we have different board games that we play, and that's really, really, really good. One is kind of a, for me, one of the groups is a friends I've had for a long time that they just got into gaming, and the other group is more of a hardcore game group that I've met through different parts of my life, and we were real competitive, so it's good to have those two options. So gaming wise 2011 was really good. Experienced a lot of games, started being on Board Game Geek. I've traded games to people in Israel, New York, Washington. I'd never done that before, so that was I learned a lot about gaming this year and how to get involved in it more than I ever had before. Now versus 2012, what the plans for my gaming is, a couple things. One, we're taking this BillCon and we're trying to push it to another level. If you don't know what BillCon is, BillCon was a small group, and we go out to a lake and we game for a weekend, Friday through Sunday. And it's a beautiful 100 acres of just nothing but games and a lake and trees and nothing else.
An excellent wolf games by the lake.
Yep. Right? Bonfire, wolf game. And it's a good way so you can focus and just kind of have good fellowship with your fellow gamers. But we're going to try to do something a little bit more with it next year. We're going to increase the numbers from an 8 to maybe a 16 and maybe involve some camping and things like that with it. So that's what I'm looking forward to in 2012. Is that aspect, and I'm going to continue the things that I've done in 2011, bring them forward, and just add to it. But yeah, 2012, I foresee being a big year for the BillCon 3.
Donald.
All right. I had a pretty big 2011. I got to go to Gen Con, which was an amazing feat. If you haven't gotten a chance to listen to the episode, the second episode we posted was our review of Gen Con 2011. I definitely recommend it. We had a lot of really cool high points and things that we're kind of looking for Gen Con of 2012. But the biggest highlight for me when it came to Gen Con was the fact that I even got to go, because about 2 weeks prior, I had my wife and I had our second son, Daniel. And so it was a big deal for me to be able to take my whole family to Gen Con. We weren't even sure if we were going to make it, much less if we were going to have the whole family there. So it was very cool for me to be able to do something like that with my whole family. I will be very surprised if my two sons grow up and are not gamers in some way, shape, or form, considering who their mom and dad are.
Joey counts based upon dice.
Yeah, he can count to 12 now. Uh-huh. I'm just saying.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So that was a huge point in my life last year for 2011. Getting into like the official mode of playing Pathfinder over playing 3.5, which I love 3.5. And the foundation that set for me and my role playing in general, but there's a lot of really cool things that I've experienced with Pathfinder and getting into that kind of thing. So being able to expound on that experience is going to be really cool for me in 2012. Let's see, in gaming in general, BillCon. I got to go to BillCon for the first year. Michael and myself and Josh on the panel, we were invited to go to BillCon this last year, and I know we're all looking forward to, as well as whoever else gets invited, is definitely looking forward to that. We've also talked about doing like a marriage experience or couples experience when it comes to gaming and camping and stuff. So that should be a lot of fun, because pretty much every one of our girlfriends and or wives are gamers to some extent or another, which is very cool for us. In 2012... I work for an establishment that sells a lot of games, and so the console computer gaming genre is going to explode, I see, in 2012 from where it has left off in 2011 with so many amazing console games that have just been released between Modern Warfare 3 and Battlefield 3 and the new Assassin's Creed Revelations game, and the anniversary copy of Halo, which I can't even believe it's been 10 years since that game came out. Mm. But you got Halo 4, and you've got, there's just a ton of avenues that console gaming and games like that is going to go. But really, what I'm really looking forward to, and I look forward to every year, is Gen Con. It's the 45th annual Gen Con. I believe the theme for this year is No Game Left Behind, and that is my plan. I plan on getting a hotel room with my wife and two kids so that we can sleep downtown and be at the convention center early so we can just game our guts out. That is the highlight of my life. It is a four-day holiday for me. The other thing I'm kind of looking forward to is I would really... like to look forward to trying to go to HoosierCon, which is a local convention here in Indiana that we have every March. I believe it is the second or third weekend in March. It's like the 15th or 16th, but they have a website. It's HoosierCon, but it's not Hoosier like Indiana Hoosier. It's Hoos, as in WHOYERCon. So if you're looking for it, you want to Google it, it's HoosierCon. But it's very cool. They raise money for charities and things like that. I believe it's a free con. You just donate money. They have a lot of really cool games and stuff. So I want to go to that. And then, of course, as we kind of talked about, we have a cruise scheduled for October. So there is tons of really cool things that I'm looking forward to in 2012. And, of course, it hasn't even started yet, really. So, I mean... There's tons of stuff to come that we probably don't even know about. So, that's my versus. That's my 2011 versus 2012. So,
Wild Bill, you had a comment to throw on there?
Yeah, I'm gonna disagree with Don here. Don is not breeding gamers. He's breeding offensive linemen.
Yeah. Hey, I don't want to hear it. Your kid is a month younger than mine, and he's bigger than my child.
I thought you were going to disagree with Don about being invited to BillCon. I was going to laugh. That was going to be great.
Yeah.
I would cry.
I was told that was a standing invite.
And to anybody who wants to know, HoosierCon is March 2nd through the 4th Clarion Waterfront Hotel.
Great. So, and that is, I think, on the north side?
I believe so.
Northeast side of town, I think. I don't know. You can look it up. They got a website. It's a really good website.
So I guess that leaves me.
Yes, sir.
We don't care about you.
Oh, well, cool. Right on.
I care about you,
nothing
Mike.
Big is happening in my life.
It's all about you.
Not at all.
Nothing
anyway.
Big.
No, nothing at all.
Start with 2011.
So, 2011 versus 2012. First off, in 2011, we started this crazy idea of having this podcast.
Oh, that's right.
Of some local friends getting together and talking about gaming. And who in the world would have thought that we would have stuck to it this long? And I have a blast with this every time we get together.
Oh, yes.
But the hallmark event in 2011 for me is I got married to my wife in 2011. And I subsequently then took her to Gen Con. So it was kind of like a double whammy. I got married. I have a wonderful wife, and she went to Gen Con. So that's like a win-win.
I believe she bought her first set of dice.
She did buy her first set of dice, which is a major victory in any gamer to gamer girlfriend, or to even now to the gamer wife step.
That's right.
She demands to go next year.
And she has even made her first character now.
That's right.
Didn't she demand to go next year?
Yes, she has. She has already told her boss that she is taking the days off for Gen Con. It doesn't matter what's going on.
Yeah. I scheduled off for that August a month ago.
Good job.
So, my 2011, I thought was, man, there's absolutely no possible way that I'm going to be able to live up to the amazingness that happened in 2011. And you know, as I stood back and as I looked at 2012 coming up. I was just like, man, this year is going to be, you know, it's the first full calendar year that I'm going to be married. There's just a lot of things that you know, are rolling over from this awesome year I had in 2011. And then my wife came to me and told me that we were pregnant. So,
you were pregnant, Mike?
Well, you know, I hide it well. Yeah, she...
sympathy pains.
Yeah, right? I do believe, and I'll go on the record, that I have picked up her cravings, because she said she hasn't craved anything, and I have demolished apples. I have been eating apples like they're going out of style. I am not joking. But anyway, we are having a little boy, and he is due at the end of April. And hopefully with Don, I will be able to experience... Gen Con as a family unit.
Yeah.
And that comes with all sorts of woes and trials and tribulations, like, you know, putting armor on your stroller so you can walk through the exhibit hall.
Painting your child's skin black and their hair white so you can dress as a drow. It's not easy with a 5-month-old.
Yeah, I don't imagine they're too cooperative.
I do have to say, though, for Mike, though, is the child will be a little older versus Dawn a couple days.
Yeah.
No, mine was 2 weeks, yeah.
Two weeks.
Ooh, a whole 2 weeks.
2 weeks.
Mm.
Yeah.
So,
Dr. Deb, can you actually in vitro inject dice into the womb?
Oh, wow.
I guess that gives new meaning to Jeremy's gaming since the womb.
Yes.
Derek, put your chupa away.
We do not recommend
it. I thought that was a good act.
It was pretty good.
It's kind of like vaccinations. We don't recommend that until about, mentally enough, about 2 weeks old, because at that time their immune systems can stand up to dice, and they can start to be able to process that and not have an adverse reaction. So, about 2 weeks is a good... Don hit it perfectly. It was amazing.
Always roll high in their favor.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I don't recommend having a 2-week-old at Gen Con. Just so anyone knows, we have pretty much set the standard now that no longer Are you allowed to get pregnant between, I believe, what is it, the months of...
November and January.
November and January. Before or after, you're okay, but November and January, nothing. You gotta live in a burlap sack.
Go ahead, Bill.
First of all, Mike, congratulations on that.
Thanks, sir.
I'm not sure if I was aware of that or not. So
you are now.
That is amazing. And then having kids in gaming, you get to teach them faster. They learn things by doing. It's fantastic. And to go along with the dice and the baby, similar to speaking to the belly, you can roll dice on the belly so they're familiar with that sound. So I think that is a good substitute for that.
That's awesome.
I love it.
There you go.
You can, if you're going to do formula, you can try and find like an ice tray that has molds for like, you know, dice, D20s and D6s and stuff, and then just freeze it and throw it in the bottle and warm it up.
Someone does have a Kickstarter project now for chocolate dice.
Oh, those won't last.
So that obviously is going to be my highlight of 2012. His name is going to be Caden Michael. So I'm super excited about that. Also, like some of the other guys have mentioned, in 2012, I am going to take our gaming group into a new area of gaming. We have been pretty much, hands down, the D20 supported system running in either Dungeons & Dragons 3.5 or any small limited exposure we've had to 4.0 and now Pathfinder. But I'm going to take... My gaming group here, and I'm going to rip them out of their comfort zone, and I'm going to throw them into a 7C game.
I am totally looking forward to this.
And I mean, this is going to be introduction to Roll and Keep, introduction to 7C. This is going to be like a nice, long, drawn-out process to introduce these guys into a new avenue of gaming, and I am super excited about that. I do what I can.
I think another thing we're going to attempt to do is the first game that I know of that I have either played or run where you have two alternating DMs for the exact same campaign.
Correct. So
you're running with that?
Okay. It was an idea that Donald and I have kicked around.
Not the 7C game. Sorry.
Right.
It's a different game, but
we are going to put together a game that is one campaign run by two DMs, and it lets you. Kind of catch flavor of different areas of different people's style and running of that nature. So that'll be interesting. That'll be interesting and new and different. So I'm pretty excited about that. As we wrap up our discussion from 2011 to 2012, I cannot help but think of all of the crazy things that people come up with as the new year is upon us, with the new year's resolutions. I'm going to lose lots of weight, or I'm going to hit the lottery, or I'm going to get this awesome job. So how fitting can it possibly be that we discuss the gamer's resolution? Now, unlike New Year's resolution, I would like some of these, if not all of them, to be somewhat obtainable. Lady and gentlemen, we're going to talk about your gamer's resolution. Could be small things like, you know what, I really just want to open up that 4.0 book more and just kind of give it a chance. Or it could be as large as, man, I want to sit down with Derek and I'm going to invent a whole new system. So you know,
prepared, Derek.
No pressure.
No pressure.
No pressure, Derek.
So as we open this up, I'm going to kind of quickly glance around. Deb's got her hand up, so she's feeling brave and frisky. So Deb, what is your gamer resolution?
Okay. So the one that I think I'm actually going to keep is that I resolve in 2012 that I will get out the war game that I mentioned in episode 2, and I am going to have a day, or maybe a couple of days, knowing that game, a weekend maybe, that we are going to have a group of us come over and we are going to play the war game, and we're going to have a winner at the end, and we are just going to go totally crazy with our World War II board game, because I had way too much fun with that and I want to play. And I also vow that somehow I will figure out what a marriage con is and that I will attend one as soon as I figure out what it is and where it is.
It will never
die. That may not happen in 2012. I'm going to try hard. It may have to be 13, but
it ain't been there much long anyway. So,
Deppah, as long as, when you figure out marriage con, mm-hmm. I think it's the same time when I figure out funeral con. So
beautiful, it'll happen at the same time. Oh no!
I
so
hate
at that
you,
time,
Derek.
We need to bring out World of Darkness so we can have the vampires and the werewolves hey. Playing at funeral con.
Oh. Just as long as they don't sparkle.
Oh
no!
No,
that was a cheap
no.
shot.
That was a cheap shot, but. Yeah.
Wow. Yeah,
you know that film made like over $130 million.
I don't care. It's horrible.
Hey, come on now.
That should be a versus topic for another day.
That's true. Yes,
well, Team saying, Edward just, versus Team I'm Jacob. Sorry. How about Team Silver Steak?
No, no. Wow. More like Twilight vampires versus like
what has happened?
Vampire.
Ladies and gentlemen, I want to remind everyone that we are talking about gamers' resolution.
I resolve that I will not watch the fourth Twilight movie.
Oh. No, she said the fourth, meaning she's probably seen the other three.
No, I saw the first two, and then I gave it up for ever.
Did you give it up for
Derek? Late? I see that you are. Well, I don't really see, but I imagine that you have your hand up and you're jumping and chomping at the bit. What do you got there?
I've actually got two resolutions. My first resolution is to beat your character's body count with Chupa.
No. I don't believe that's humanly possible unless
give it a try.
But it's
unless,
Ewoki
unless
impossible.
Unless of course you have some kind of world planet explosion.
Oh no.
You almost had that.
Oh no.
Yeah, that's next. Oh. And then my other resolution is to find a local gaming group here and possibly form one.
Corrupt them, you mean?
That sounds awesome.
Excellent. Yeah. Well, yes, that and corrupt them. I mean, that's just obvious. I mean,
yes.
How can you not have a group and then not corrupt them?
You've got to gather them first. Then.
Where's the fun?
Yeah.
Wild Bill?
Okay. My New Year's gamer resolution. I have owned a game store. I have played a ton of board games here recently over the last few years, but I have not actually played in a RPG since 1999.
Okay, we need to correct that.
Wow.
What?
Wow.
So my new
what are you
year's
doing
resolution
tomorrow night?
Yeah, seriously.
Is to play in a RPG and have it last for a year. Okay. And the reason behind that is some of it's kind of it's my own fault because
you keep having kids.
I've had two kids. Been married for 12 years.
Ran a game store.
Yep. Because I'm very picky about that because I'm a story driven guy. I don't want to play in an RPG that's hack and slash. If I want to do that, I would just play board games that I really enjoy, and I'm looking for a different experience with that. And so I would love to play in an RPG for a year. My other resolution. I'm not having a revolution here.
Revelation.
Revelation.
There you go.
Resolution.
Oh.
And this is something that I've thought about since last Gen Con, and is that when I go to a con, I have to learn. This is something totally against how I normally am, but I have to learn to be selfish with my time, and because you make so many commitments sometimes, or you say yes to too many people, mm-hmm. and you start taking away from your own experience. And I have to learn to sometimes be selfish. And I know that sounds bad, but if I can learn to do that this year, my closer group of friends will enjoy their time with me more if I do that.
It's awesome, Tony.
For me, it's got to be getting into playing more games. The other resolution that I've got is to see out our gaming table concept that we've got. We are currently working on an idea to create a lower end cost gaming table to something we've seen at Gen Con to be able to for a more affordable option for the gamer who doesn't have a ton of money. So that is really a big one for me, is to see it as far as we can go with it.
Awesome. Donald?
I've been thinking about it long and hard, or at least for a couple hours, and I can't say that I really have just one singular resolution, but I would have to say my big resolution slash goals for the year of 2012 would have to be to play in a role play game once a month, or at least on a regular basis, and then I would really enjoy expanding my ownership and or playing experience when it comes to new games, because there are a lot of really good new games that are out that I have yet to experience, and especially something that can be played in two-player mode where my wife and I can sit down and play at home as well. That is my resolution, to expand my realm of gaming, or my knowledge, I should, my knowledge and experience of gaming, and then to be able to game on a more regular basis versus so sporadic, and only being able to be at a game once every other month or once every 2 months because of, you know, some other commitment when I can, you know, try and schedule that in. So those would be my big hitters. And getting a hotel room for Gen Con. That is a must this year. Yeah. That is definitely one of my goals for the year.
Courtyard by the Marriott was fantastically priced.
I think because my wife works at a hotel downtown, I think we're going to try and see if we can't finagle our way in there, because they were not sold out last year. And they're only about 4 blocks away. So it's still not bad. It beats driving and parking.
Amen. Josh?
Well, I think a lot of us are in that boat to do that again next year. There'll be some that'll want to do the group thing. I think my wife and I are actually going to look into either doing one ourselves or just a couple other people. That way we're not jamming a bunch
there
of people
into
our room.
There is no time at Gen Con to have a room by yourself.
Well, it does help with the whole, like, not needing to negotiate with 4 other people for the shower.
Oh.
It does kind of help.
You take showers at Gen Con?
Well, it's jump in, jump out. Oh. You know, like,
you
get wet
showers?
And
oh.
get out again. But, yeah.
Yeah, okay. I do too.
Okay.
This is why we're not going to be staying with you.
That's right.
Yes, Bill? You ready to say so? Okay. Well,
I'll go ahead and say it since you brought it
that's
up.
That's fine.
Just so everyone knows, when Don said, you guys say showers at Gen Con, everyone in the room was nodding their heads. You can't see that.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
It's quite funny.
Okay. Wow. Apparently, I'm the only one that showers at Gen Con.
And the second time.
Okay.
Number one, for me is, finally completing this, campaign based off of, the Alderac Entertainment Group's World's Largest City that came out a few years ago. I've held onto this book for quite some time, was very interested in it, and, we're utilizing the source to develop a, historical backstory to the world of Pelagane that Derek is developing, and we have four of the 7 people in this room, and Ragar is a part of it as well. There's 8 people playing in the game, and my resolution is to finish the thing. There's 8 to 10 sessions left in it, based off what I've got worked out, and I've had this story brewed up for the last 4 years, I think, and I really would like to finish it. I'm really looking forward to the 7C game, don't get me wrong, but I want to get World's Largest City finished. I've been driving to get that finished. But I think the other part of it is finding a way to make gaming even more convenient at my apartment here. We do very well for what the setup we've got in here. I think it works out relatively well. We've got D20 Pro, as Derek mentioned earlier. We've got Skype set up. We're even recording now with Derek via Skype. We've got a pretty good amount of technology, but even trying to simplify it, the gaming table concept's been brought up, different things, whatever, finding space, finding time. I think that making it as enjoyable as possible for the locals, but also giving Derek, our friend John in Oklahoma, you know, anyone else that say we want to get a group together and somebody can't make it because they're homesick with their kid, but still giving them the option to maybe remote in and, you know, play with this as well. I think that's something that I really want to explore in 2012 as we continue on.
Derek, what you got?
A lot. There have been several people that have basically said that they want to game more, that they want to, that we want to finish games. It's just, it seems like, I think people are getting back into this after taking some hiatuses and that sort of thing. And I think that between our group, which is continually growing, we can make this all happen. I know that there's scheduling issues a lot of the time, but I think between the group of us, I think we can make this happen and make these actually attainable New Year's resolutions. I think that we have a good time when we game, and it's a great way to enjoy each other's company. So I think that I'm glad to hear that people want to do this more often and that sort of thing.
So as we're coming to an end here, I have my gamer's resolution, and mine, not unlike what I talked about in my 2012, is my goal as a gamer in 2012 is to just drag these guys and ladies, because there will be some others that will participate, but drag them into a world that is not unlike what Bill was saying. It's not so much about the hack and slash. It's not so much about, you know, raiding this dungeon. It's not so much about, you know, getting down and getting dirty. It's so much about locking you into a story that if you miss, you will miss so much that you will feel like your character, you'll feel like you were like ill in an inn, and the party went out and did all this awesome stuff and came home and just told you about it, and you're just kind of going, you got this little sad look on your face, and you've just missed everything. Now don't get me wrong, there's time and a place in all those games for combat and stuff like that, but what I really want to do is, and I've been working on this this campaign that I'm going to run these guys through for a couple of months, and I have this epic story drawn out before them. Of course, I'm going to run them through a nice little feet warmer to get them all introduced to the system, introduced to what's going on, kind of get their background set. But my New Year's resolution for them is to take them into a story that, if it, you know, God willing, if it lasts 5 years, like a game that we played in before, that when the game ends, they will be so emotionally attached to their character that they will bring tears to their eyes. So that's my goal. My goal is to enrapture them into a story that locks them as a person, as a being, to their character. So I'm working really hard to do that. I'm working really hard to try and make it interesting and also make it exciting, which is why I think the 7th C guys, when they get into the system and see how it works, it really plays into that.
7C is a really good system for that, Mike.
So, that's my really quick my gamer's resolution. Of course, I always have to, like Deb, I have my hand up. I'm vowing that I will take my wife to Gen Con, and I will take my son to Gen Con, and it'll be Don and his wife and his kids, and me and my wife and my kid strolling around to Gen Con. So,
sweetie, I'm feeling some pressure here.
I don't know what you're talking about.
No, we're in November.
Right. That's true.
You got 2 to 3 Sorry. Months.
Burlap sack.
3 months. Yeah.
Burlap sack.
This is a blackout.
Yeah. <Mm-mm.
laughs> So, Yeah, that's what I'm that's what I'm looking at for my resolution is I wanna pull these guys into a game that I hope they get a lot out of, and I wanna just expand the amount of gaming that goes on not only with the group that I play with, but also as a family unit, because there's a lot of value that I think as a whole that you lose that this country has lost when, you know, most families don't sit around the table and eat anymore.
Yeah.
You know, most people don't sit around and tell how their day was, and they don't, you know, whatever. And that gives, you know, if you say, hey, the second Saturday of the month, we're going to sit down and we're going to play D&D or we're going to play whatever, and it gives you that time as a family to be together. And I really think that there's a lot of value in that, and I know my wife shares the same outlook on it, and we will raise our son in that value of, you know, spending time with the ones that you love, showing them that you love them, and enjoying their company. And it just so happens that all of my friends that I'm with enjoy the same things that I do. So it makes it nice and convenient. So as we wrap up this evening, I have to establish that in our last show that without a shadow of a doubt, no one ever, and I mean ever, once, fruitcake.
Ever.
It's really not a laughing matter.
Ever.
Ever.
It's really pretty serious.
Oh, I'm laughing because I know that feeling, and it just it resonates so deeply within me because I've felt that before. Like, finally, someone is speaking the truth and is being strong about it.
I'm going to make a WWE reference again. Ever.
Yeah.
Run away.
So as we go to establish the new fact, I have a nice combo fact this evening. I know that, like, drum rolls and everything.
It's the first year, we got to start them off with a bang.
That's right. First off, there is a gaming code. If you are to attend Gen Con, you are absolutely positively never ever
allowed to bring
never ever allowed to get pregnant between November and December.
That's right, it's a lockout.
It is blocked out.
Bedroom lockout.
Yes.
Oh, sad face.
But the fact that I want to establish on the tail end of that is I wish I might have this resolution that we make tonight.
Oh, that's so cute.
So, thanks for joining us. This has been episode 12.
Happy New Year.
Of the Established Facts.
Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
Bye-bye.